Okay, so welcome everyone. So it's 7 a.m. here, but 1 p.m. Conference time. Welcome everyone to the session on effects. Always exciting to see continuations, monads, always present. We have three talks. The first talk is by presented by Mateusz on continuation path composing style, a reflection on composing style, one of my favorite topics. Please, Mateusz, take it away.
Thank you. So let's start. first, I guess my audience is well versed in CPS, or at least somewhat familiar. Yeah, it's a style of programming where each function has an additional parameter, and this parameter represents the entirety of the rest of computation. This continuation is either passed down to another function whenever something is going on, or called when we have nothing more to do. And in this continuation passing style, the continuation, so the future of execution, is always made explicit. While in direct style, to contrast it, it's mostly implicit, except for very specific cases when we want to flesh out the continuation to show it via control operators. So we can discern three kinds of continuation usage in now. There are pure continuations, which are in tape positions. They always use the current continuation, the one that was introduced the latest. There is always exactly one occurrence of each continuation. There can be also abortive continuations, which might ring a bell about call CC, call with current continuation. Then we have any number of occurrences of continuations. We may use not the current continuation, but some earlier defined continuation or any whatsoever. And we still require that these are used in tail positions, in tail calls. And in composable usage, all those requirements are lifted. So we can use any number of occurrences. It may be not the current one. It may be some earlier one, and doesn't have to be in tail position. So we can essentially compose them, put one onto another. Control operators now, shift and reset. These were introduced as a tool for dealing with delimited continuations, and its semantics were given by CPS. Later on, independently, evaluation rules were introduced. And here's an example, very quick example, how you could make use of these operators. Here you have a combinator choose, which chooses non-deterministically an element of a list, and it fails if it cannot. And a little bit below is a puzzle. A puzzle is about finding a pair of integers such that those integers multiply together to give 28. And I have given a red color for uses of explicit continuation. So you can see that there are not so many in this program. And all the other stuff is implicit. And this green bracket is operation of making a singleton list. And this is the continuation around the call to this puzzle procedure. And that's the thing that will get captured together with other stuff whenever we stamp on the shift operator. So what was our goal? So far, obviously, since the beginning, there was a known CPS transformation for shift and reset. Also, by Kamegawa and, sorry, I cannot pronounce, There was also given a sound and complete axiomatization of equality for with respect to CPS transformation. As a byproduct, there was devised some inverse translation modulo equality, but equality has a big flaw. It is undirected. So until now, there wasn't any translations that would respect direction of reductions between direct style and CPS with composable continuations. There was a similar result for pure continuations by Sabri and Wadler, but not in the case of abortive or composable continuations. So what we have given here is we have proposed a revised calculus with shift and reset, and we have given it CPS transformation. We have a right inverse modulo syntactic equality for this transformation, and it also happens to be a left inverse modulo administrative reductions, those inessential reductions that, for example, rearrange let expressions. So first, a quick recap on Galois connections. A function is monotone whenever it maintains the order of arguments to results. A Galois connection then is one would say a pair of function such that they are to get inverses of each other up to properly used reduction relations. Reduction on or order depends on your application. And then a reflection is a Galois connection which is exact in one direction, while preordered isomorphism is exact in both directions. So these are two monotone functions which are exact inverses of each other. And each reflection can be decomposed into a pair of two other Galois connections. One of them will be a reflection and another will be an order isomorphism. And the mediating calculus, mediating preordered set would be the image of the second monotone function G, the image of B via this function G. And one of these, the reflection we will call inclusion, and the other obviously isomorphism. So now we start with introducing our brand new calculus lambda CS, which is a mild variation on Moji's computational calculus lambda C. As you can see, all we have done is we added shift as a value, as a combinator to values, and reset as an extra category of non-values. Also, differently than in other formulations of shift and reset, we have introduced let expressions in order to be consistent with the program of Moji and others. As you can see, there are quite a lot of reduction rules, but all except the last two were already introduced in computational calculus of Moji. The last two are just added to accommodate for our new control operators. And we, as you can see, we can capture any pure continuation, and it's turned into a lambda expression in the role beta S. Now, reflection follows. In order to give a reflection, we need to find those two functions. The first of them is CPS transformation. Again, it's mostly the same as what we have seen so far. The innovation is when it comes to control operators. As you can see, the translation of reset involves column transformation, which uses as a continuation the identity continuation, the simplest one. And it's not an open term, as you can see. And shift is directly translated to a unique, different than everything else in this system, combinator, which captures the behavior of shift. All right, so now that we have given CPS transformation, we need to characterize its image. And we characterize it using grammars again. But this time, you can notice those little deltas. So we have indexed grammars. These terms and continuations are indexed by a current continuation variable. But sometimes there is none. So we denote those situations with this bullet symbol. As you can see, we have an extra term for resets. We have an extra value for shift. And we have an extra continuation for trivial continuations. For trivial, which are not when there are no, when there is no current continuation. And rules that you can see here, there are only six of them. And those two lower are the counterparts in CPS of the rules that you have seen two slides before. Now we get back to direct style. And we arrive at the subcalculus of Lambda CS. We call it Lambda CS right triangle or kernel direct style calculus. And this calculus will be isomorphic to the CPS calculus. Now, as you can see, when we have already established the grammar for CPS terms, going back is straightforward. The transformations involved are not having any extra parameters. And as you can expect, those extra additions to grammar of terms are turned into reset and shift, respectively. Now we need to characterize this image, the image of hash transformation. And there is one noteworthy thing about this system is that because we need to maintain this invariant that each and every term in this kernel calculus is normalized in terms of administrative reductions. So those involving rearrangement and introduction of let expressions. Then we need to keep this rearrangement whenever we perform beta reductions. So we use this extra colon to do it for us whenever it is needed. Now that we have established this direct style transformation and this kernel calculus, we can decompose the star that we started with into two parts, and one of them is CPS transformation from kernel to CPS. This is a five-legged star, and it's just a trimming of the original one to this smaller calculus. And this time, because the shape of this kernel calculus is very specific, the transformation is again a little bit easier. And obviously, this together with previously introduced transformation hash, they form an isomorphism. Now, the other part is about inclusion. So this right triangle transformation, what it does for us, it performs all possible administrative reductions. And it can be derived via computation of composition of hash and star of asterisk. So now we turn our focus to this calculus lambda s, which should be somewhat more similar to languages that were studied in the past, which had those shift operator. And this is basically lambda CS, but without let expressions. And yeah, that's just it. Then we have a kernel direct style subcalculus, which we derive using the original right triangle transformation on this restricted set of terms. And it's obviously similar to the system that we have seen before, the previous kernel, but what is different is that we need to maintain stack discipline of let bound variables. Variables are used in a linear manner, and they are used in the order as they are introduced. So the least recent, so the most recently introduced variable is the one that we have to use first. Now, in contrast to what was the case in the wider lambda CS calculus, this time we can find an exact inverse for this operation of normalizing with respect to administrative reductions. So we can basically undo all those administrative reductions. And by undoing it, I mean deleting all let expressions that were introduced using those rules, those administrative rules. And the definition is quite simple. We just, whenever we see a let expression, we might turn it into its folded version, which does not involve let. We perform a substitution. You can see there's also a case which says that sometimes we don't do anything, but it is only the case when we consider the wider lambda CS calculi. We can narrow this left triangle to exactly match our domain and codomain of interest, and then this extra rule does not ever apply, because all the let expressions that occur in lambda S right triangle calculus, they all are linear in the way they use those let bound variables, and they are those uses are pure. So this variable X that was let bound is in a pure context always. And now, now we can also characterize lambda S star, the image of lambda S via CPS transformation. But I won't show you this one because it's quite repetitive. You already seen kernel, you already seen CPS on wider calculus. So this one has to keep track of both those temporary variables, which are let bound, and keep track of present, perhaps present because it's optional, perhaps present current continuation. So the bookkeeping in this calculus is more involved, but after all, it's not very enlightening to go through it. And since we have established this one, now by narrowing the original isomorphism in the wider calculi, we can get an isomorphism between those lambda s star and kernel calculus. And now, since we have two isomorphisms, we have an isomorphism between lambda s and kernel, and between kernel and CPS, we can compose these two isomorphisms, and we arrive at this pair of transformations. One of them is the star, but narrowed, and the other is, we call it diamond, as our biggest jewel in the crown of this paper. And it performs a one pass first order direct state transformation. It uses a stack of expressions which are plugged into the result whenever the variable that they correspond to occurs in CPS. So we come to an end, but first, to make it more understandable, I can show you now the example. So for brevity, we will use this shortcut that this letter S stands for the combinator that shift operator is transformed to. And now you can see a simple expression which is both in lambda S and lambda CS calculus. And when you transform it via CPS transformation, it obviously gets a little bit longer. But since we have used colors, you can track what gets transformed into what. Note that this term obviously has a feature that prevents it from being a very simple CPS. Because as you can see, there is indeed composition of continuations. You can see that this first parenthesis form a continuation, and it is applied to a expression which is not a value itself. So we have a composition here occurring. And when we go back to direct style via hash transformation, we get to this very same that we started with, but we have given a name. I have dubbed it R for this sub expression. And when we use deletion of let expressions, we can go back to where we started. And in fact, when you take those three terms, you can use any of those six arrows, any of those six transformations, and they should click. So in summary, we have established a reflection for this calculus with let expressions. And using this fact, we also managed to establish an isomorphism for calculus which has no let expressions. So there is this one-to-one correspondence, and this correspondence is also respective of reductions in both calculi. So what can be done next? Well, it looks like this can be easily transformed into a similar argument for abortive continuations. Perhaps you could get away without combinator, and you could define shift as it is traditionally done as a binder. Perhaps we could liberalize grammar for CPS, because right now it's not easy to write by hand such a thing. And what is currently done, we are trying to give a similar result for shift zero, which in turn hopefully will allow us to give such a reflection also for algebraic effects. And that's our current focus. So thank you.
Thank you. So we have a couple of questions on the Q&A. And in fact, I was going to ask the first question, so I'm glad somebody asked it. So one of the major kind of issues with these composable continuations was the typing. So the question is there a typed version of these results?
The answer is no. We haven't yet considered a typing for these. So all of it is untyped. So there's only this thing. And perhaps we could use one of those typed versions and see if it goes through. I cannot say for sure, but we cannot see for now why it wouldn't go through with typing. But we haven't.
Yeah, I think that would be exciting because, I mean, if you have on the CPS side simple types, you can maybe go back and find interesting types on the shift side. There's also a question from Kenichi Asai. First, it's a great work, thank you. And is the CPS language the same as the one by Kameyama and Hasegawa? Or is it different? And if different, how different?
Yeah, it's very, very different. I mean, they are fundamentally different because what have Kameyama and Hasegawa done, they were considering, I would say, a two CPS. They had two continuations in the CPS. There was this usual continuation and meta continuation. So in the end, what they arrived at, they had a system which would never perform an application in which an argument wouldn't be a value, which is a normal thing for CPS when it's pure, but when we consider composable version, then no. But we can see no reason why we couldn't give a competing similar to CPS based on this work, because we can just apply this transformation that we have created and again apply this one or the one of Sabri and Wadler, because as you can see, this CPS does not involve any control operators, so we can use this or that. And after those two twice iterated CPS, we should arrive at something similar to what Kameyama and Hasegawa did, but perhaps there still would be some slight differences.
Okay, so there's like more questions, but let's take one more quickly. Can you briefly talk about what challenges do you anticipate if you wanted to do shift zero? Why is shift zero more difficult in your setting?
So far, it looks like it's more. The challenge is that there are some spurious eta reductions involved. I mean, continuations in shift zero behave somewhat differently. In fact, in that you can capture any number as many continuations as you like, because there are no delimiters, and because of that, this number of extra continuations that are in the CPS may grow, may shrink, and to maintain some grammatical normal form, we must either give up the syntactic equality and go for equality up to eta reduction, or we need to decide in which cases should we force the performing of some eta reductions. I mean, eta reductions of the form, for example, when you transform a few steps before.
So I think, in just finish briefly because we're...
Okay.
Yeah.
The thing is, you have this continuation after application. When you translate application, you have continuations after it, and it may be the case that it's the whole term is an application, so this continuation is just the variable, and you can reduce the continuation, and that's the main problem.
Okay, thank you. Let's thank our speakers. A virtual clap. Thank you.